Hey, my name is Everett Mohan, although you might know me better as Aspiring Spike on the internet. I'm back here today to record another modern video for Channel Fireball, and today I'm playing this Dimir Asmo Manufacturer Time Sieve Shredder Infinite Combo deck that I've been working on for the last couple weeks. This archetype of make a lot of food tokens and tokens in general with Academy Manufacturer, just a bunch of food tokens with Cookbook, and then sack five of those tokens to a Time Sieve to take ideally infinite turns or just a few turns at start. This archetype's been around for a while. It sort of entered my consciousness when I first saw Canister MTG playing it on stream, and then there was like kind of this arms race where like Canister MTG, Doomwake, myself, Sam Pardee, and a few other deck builders were really, really working on this archetype, trying to see if this was finally the Underworld Cookbook Asmo shell that finally broke the combination of discarding a Daredevil to Cookbook over and over and over again. And I've spent a long time working on this. I've seen a lot of different people take a crack at it, and it's always just felt not quite there. It always has felt like it's missing something. And there was recently a 5-0 in the deck in the dumps, which was pretty much like very similar to the older list. It was playing like Cat Oven, Disciple of the Vault, a bunch of different cards than what I'm playing here, to be honest. But seeing that the list in the 5-0 dumps made me want to return to it with Ledger Shredder, a card that I've found to be a big upgrade for a lot of different decks and different archetypes. And this card is kind of perfect for the shell where you have a really low curve. Asmo is actually really good at getting you to cast two spells on the same turn to trigger Shredder. You have Oval Chase Daredevils in your deck, which you are really happy to be looting away constantly to actually be generating card advantage from Shredder's Connives. And this is an archetype that really likes to play Unearth, where Shredder is not only a really good card to Unearth because it's really easy to go Unearth, play a different spell, trigger your Shredder, but Unearth is just really good to hit your Imries and your Manufactors and your Asmos. And in the past, it always felt like to me this deck was just like one good Unearth target away from really being there. And so I've been hammering out the list a little bit. I've been changing like a lot of cards in the main deck sideboard, tweaking the mana base, all that, just really spending some time tuning it. And I've been playing it a lot on stream lately, and I have been really, really liking it. It's been like a really good sweet spot of like fresh and competitive and fun. And I hope that we get to, show off some of that today. I think one big thing that I like to do that a lot of people don't is I like to play the full four time sieves. I see a lot of people building this archetype with like two, three, sometimes playing like War of Invention for time sieve, but I think you just want to play the full four. In my opinion, the biggest issue with these Asmo Urza Saga decks in the past is that their engine is like grindy and resilient or whatever, but a lot of decks just don't care about it. A lot of decks are just doing their own thing, ignoring your engine, removing your creatures, and just doing their own thing. And so having access to this infinite turn combo, which can kill us, you can take infinite turns as soon as turn three. We've done that like three or four times, but more often turn four, turn five. Just having access to an infinite combo in this archetype is so, so important. And in my opinion, like, should be this deck's plan A in a lot of matchups, and you really want access to that plan A in game ones. And then in sideboard games, I often like will be siding out time sieves in the more interactive matchups. But the idea is, the food decks are like already pretty good in those more interactive matchups. They're really resilient, they're grindy, they have Asmo to like blow up a lot of creatures. So I really like being on four main deck and then siding into less in sideboard games. And I think that most other versions I've seen are just like not as in on the combo. Besides that, I think the deck is like somewhat straightforward. You know, we have our general value engine, Asmo, Unearth, Cookbook, Daredevil, which we've kind of all seen time and time again. New edition Shredder. I think one small thing to note is we are playing Gigantha as a companion. This is, while castable off your treasure tokens for Manufactor and the one of Springleaf Drum, you actually mostly just want this as like an extra card to discard to your cookbooks, which actually comes up a decent amount of time, just like needing that extra card to discard. And you will lose it when you board in Fulminated Mage. Fulminated Mage will help a lot in the Titan and Tron matchups, though, which can be some of the hardest matchups to face for these Asmo archetypes. So I think that this is a really important sideboard card. I think that covers all of the important bases. We can just go ahead and jump into a league. But Before we do, I would like to remind you guys that this video is brought to you by the Channel Fireball Marketplace. You can go there and buy some Magic singles from your local game stores that are using the Channel Fireball Marketplace. And if you want, you can use code SPIKE at checkout and help support me and what I do. But without any further ado, we can go ahead and play some games. Okay, we're on to play with a really interesting first hand here. It's hand really, really, really likes to, or would like to keep a, or find a cheap artifact to trigger the Shredder or have my opponent trigger Shredder so that I can unearth my Imry potentially. Second Shredder is pretty interesting, but let's let you know, just have a Shredder, hope for the best. You know, I will say against a deck that's playing Moonstare Prototype, I feel like there's a decent chance my opponent is going to trigger this for me. That's one spell. Yeah, I know you want to cast a second. It can be so difficult to play against Shredder because you just like, you don't know how important that Connive is to your opponent's hand. Like here it is actually like incredibly, incredibly important, but I will say it's usually not this, doesn't feel this key. I'm actually gonna discard second Shredder because I can go unearth here and then I can play a cookbook. And if I just draw a land off of either Connive, I'm gonna be able to get an Imry back. Oh, looks like they've got a Metallic Rebuke for the Unearth. Okay, so that's fine. Would still love to draw a land so I can Imry this turn. Although, I can't really complain too much about Ovalchase Daredevil because this card is just so good with my Shredder that's in play. Just turning this into, you know, like look at what the Shredder's done so far. It's, you know, smoothed out my draw, effectively draw me one full card with the Daredevil, and it's also a 3-5 flyer. pretty nuts stuff. Love to draw an Asmo. That would be great. Okay, we lose the Shredder, although, you know, at the cost of, you know, we got two full cards off of it and smooth out our draws. Although I guess I should say my opponent definitely should have just cast the portable hole first. They didn't need to give me this Connive. And they are gonna be able to make a Sog off their Drum and Springleaf. So their Springleaf and then their Moonsnare. But here, I think I'm just supposed to go Shredder, Imry, and then my Connive is an action. It's a real Connive this time, unfortunately. Let's just discard a Darkslick Shores. Okay, so I milled over another cookbook. So I'll just pass back here. I'm gonna wait to see what my opponent gets off this saga before I'd like just discard anything. Oh no, maybe that's not correct. Maybe I should actually just discard my Imry right now. Yeah, because if my opponent if they get like a Soul Guide Lantern or something, I'm gonna want my Daredevil to already be back in my hand, actually. Yeah, Shredder is a card that I've really, really liked and like basically every deck I've tried it in. I've played it in like my like Esper Unearth Brew. I've been playing it in Pioneer Phoenix. I've been playing it in Blue-Red Murktide in Modern. I've been playing it in Shadow in Modern. And, you know, it feels pretty good everywhere you play it. This is, I think, just a really generally powerful card. But this has definitely felt like one of the better shells in my opinion. So they get a Midmite here. So I guess they're just want to make sure that they can Springleaf Drum and equip. So I'm gonna be able to get a third food token here. Okay, kind of want to be, I want to find an untapped land pretty badly so that I can just play two more cookbooks and like have a pretty good extra turn here. Although this Mishra's Bauble is going to be another artifact towards my time sieve. So I could just sack this this Bauble if I don't find a land. So let me go ahead and cast the Bauble, trigger Connive, loot this away, bring back the Daredevil. I think this is infinite turns because we get to make now four food tokens a turn with my 4 cookbooks, and then I get to cast the Bauble every turn with the Emery. So usually for infinite turns, you need at least one manufactor. But here we have just the full 4 cookbooks. And we kind of have a running joke on my stream asking, well, Spike, now that you have infinite turns, how do you win? And obviously just a joke. It is simple enough to win with infinite turns, attacking in the air infinite times, attacking on the ground infinite times, attacking with giant Urza Saga tokens. Maybe will take some clicks, but it is pretty straightforward. The manufacturer makes it easier. I don't know if our editor can work any magic. But yeah, the opponent recognizes now that this is in fact infinite turns, packs it in, and we are up a game against blue-white affinity. Against blue-white affinity, how would I like to sideboard? I feel like Pithing Needle could be interesting against cards like Soul Guide Lantern, Cranial Plating, Nettle Cyst. Fairy Time Raveler. I think I'm interested in this over the main deck Aether Spellbomb, and I don't know that I want to board in like Bone Shards or Thoughtseize, anything like that necessarily. I may just try to be me a bit more linear in this matchup, if that makes sense. I'm just gonna click submit. I think opponent's still sideboarding. I love that we had that game for game one here, because I always, you know, the goal of these videos is always to show off the ideas at play here. And I think that the game did a great job of showcasing just what Ledger Shredder does for this archetype, where it provides a massive amount of card advantage. It provides an awesome plan B of just having a great flying attacker, and it provides an amazing amount of card selection to assemble your combo too. And then I think we also saw it work really well with the Unearth Plan as well. Just happens to fit so well in the archetype. And after playtesting this archetype for a long time, it really did always feel like it was just like missing one piece. And this I think is the piece. Okay, we could keep this. It might be interesting to lead on Urza Saga turn 1, then turn 2 we can play Shore Shredder, then turn 3 we can get a cookbook, cast an Asmo, cast a cookbook, trigger Connive. Probably better to be a bit slower in this matchup. I'm not sure though. My opponent's gone ahead and mulled to 6 on the play. Yeah, I think especially with the Shadow Spear, I think I'd rather try to actually make Urza Saga tokens. I'm also like a bit flooded here, so getting more value out of my card in some ways seems pretty relevant. Not 100% sure this is the right way, and especially being on the draw and like these Urza Saga mirrors can be quite scary, because a lot of times it's just like whoever makes the first Urza Saga token is just streets ahead. But at least I'm the player with a Ledger Shredder. I also have Asmo, which can maybe kill my opponent's tokens. Oh, they looks like they have a Metallic Rebuke here. Okay, well, I mean, they have a March of Otherworldly Light. Okay, well, this is not good for me. Oh, I forgot to mention in the deck, Shredder's also a discard outlet for Asmo, which is very relevant. Although it is getting Portable Hold here, but it looks like they're Portable Holding at the cost of making an Urza Saga token when they're on the mulligan. Oh, and sorry, I meant to say my opponent can, they could have Marched of Otherworldly Light at the Saga in response to the trigger to stop me from casting the Shredder. So that actually ended up not being, I think, that bad of an exchange for me, all said and done. Okay, this hand, I guess, really does need either a cookbook or to be able to cast the Asmo for this hand to come online, since obviously Asmo can get me the cookbook, so I can, if I could somehow find a way to cast 2 spells, which I'm not too close to here. I need to draw like Mishra's Bauble or something. Then we can cast the Asmo. And maybe my opponent, you know, ends up casting 2 spells on their turn and I get to connive. into something. Or I could just draw an Underworld cookbook. Okay, so they're going to make a 4/4 Urza Saga token. And they get a Springleaf Drum. 3 cards still in their hand. No spells cast so far. Play Seacrim Coast. Thought Monitor. 3 cards in hand. No attacks. Okay. Pretty good turn, obviously. I think this turn I'm just going to equip onto the Shredder and attack. Definitely not as good a turn as I would have wanted. My opponent March of Otherworldly Lighting on my Urza Saga has definitely been a huge, huge wrench in my hand functioning. Although it looks like there's a good chance I'm going to get to connive. But I'm also probably going to take a big hit off this Construct token. I do get to connive. Okay, so next turn I could go Manufaktor Imri Connive, but then I couldn't cast the Asmo after that. Okay, Sentinel can be good in this matchup depending on what kind of draw we have, but doesn't seem to be too scary here. Go down to 7 life. My opponent has 2 cards in their hand, and they pass. Ooh, it's a pretty interesting draw. I'm going to play the Manufaktor first so that we can cast the Imri. Connive here. Okay, I think I'll discard the Daredevil. Yeah, I was discarding Asmo was interesting because I could loot, but I think I am not attacking with the Shredder so that I can block, eat like a Thought Monitor in combat. And I have Bobble, Cookbook, Bobble in the yard. What? I feel like this attack makes no sense. It must have something. Okay. I think that they thought that their Alpha Strike was just good. Yeah, I feel like just throwing away Sentinel Thought Monitor. Like, this attack was obvious. The attack with this part was obviously fine. Not a huge deal, I guess. I'm going to go ahead and cast the... And they even, like, lost their Esper Sentinel here, too. I'm going to go cast Underworld Cookbook. Get back Daredevil. Cast Unearth. Targeting Manufaktor. Connive. Discard Oval Chase Daredevil. Return Daredevil to hand. Discard Daredevil. We can always yield to this. You can't always yes because it's a separate Daredevil each time. But now I get to go cast Asmo, Cookbook, Saga, Cookbook, discard. Pretty good turn, huh? So this is an 8/8. I have 2 treasure tokens. Probably going to be sacking my food tokens to kill something. Trying to think if I want to attack and use treasure to move the Shadow Spear over. I think attacking here makes sense. But I'm not sure if I want to move the Shadow Spear over. Because I might just want to sack a food to gain life and like either take a hit or... Like, just be better against, like, 2 removal spells or something. Because right now I feel actually really ahead. It's a good start for them. Could lose to some cards. It's got 4 cards in their hand. Seems like they've got some tricky decision. Oop, portable hole. Yeah, so they're going to target the Asmo, I think. So let's say they kill my manufacturer. I sack treasure Sekfugo to 11, but I'm still dying. Okay, I think because I can't win if they have a removal spell for my manufacturer, I should just kill the monitor here and chump block with manufacturer. I can replay manufacturer off Imri if I want to. Okay. So those two treasure tokens, I think I might use one of them and my shores to crack a clue. Because I would obviously, if we could just find a time sieve, game ends. Although Aether Spell Bomb is not too bad. Put an F6, good to know. Cast the Manufactor, get back Daredevil. Cast Aether Spare Bomb, we loot away Daredevil. Oh, wow. I'm gonna go ahead and just get my treasure tokens here. Attacking for six in the air with my Shredder. I have three treasure tokens. So I can Asmo and hold the cookbook makes a mana for me, actually, because I just get to go cookbook, discard Daredevil, and then this makes me treasure. So now I still have three treasures, two to make a Saga token and one to activate Aether Spellbomb. Then I also have three foods. I can activate Asmo once. I think it's going to be hard to lose from this position, but this is definitely like a tricky game. Cool. Very interesting match one. We advanced to 1-0. I'll see you guys in round number two. Okay, we're on the play for match number two with a pretty interesting hand. I am actually going to keep, and this hand has a few different decision trees that we can explore. I think what I'm most likely to want to do is to get a Watery Grave, play a cookbook on turn one, and then save this Bauble so that on turn I can go discard Shredder, unearth Shredder, Shredder Bauble, and try to find a land to cast the Asmo. It's a bit weird, but the Shredder just offers so much card advantage here that even if we miss on the land, it's still kind of fine. We did miss on the land, kind of fine. We'll just go Shadow Spear, pass, got a 2-4 here, doesn't die to heat, doesn't die to bolts right now. Probably should upkeep Bobbled, not that big a deal. Ridden 6, also not that big a deal. So we've had some really, I think it is important to know, we've had a good start so far. I meant to just make a food token end of turn two. But despite the fact that we've had a really good start so far, I want to make sure we note that this is definitely feels like above average draws, just like on the higher end of variance. Certainly not perfect draws, but we're maybe close. Maybe close. Yeah, it's just like the Shredder was like worth two full cards there, and it's a 3/5 flyer, blocked the Ragavan. We did have to unearth it on turn one, so that's kind of minus a card, but ended up working out all right. This is gonna be a matchup where I'm gonna want to bring in Needle in order to needle my opponent's Aether Spell Bombs. And I think I probably want to cut at least one time sieve. We could also consider playing sub number of bone shards. I think I'm kind of down to go down to two time sieves in this like really interactive matchup. It's really where you kind of want to trim on these. And then we could leave in the Nile Spell Bomb. I think I'll go ahead and trim it. Click submit. Very fast game one. go to game two pretty fast as well. Okay, this hand definitely seems a bit more fair than our other ones, but this is a matchup where I don't think you want to mulligan super aggressively. I'm going to go ahead and keep this. And we can maybe use bone shards to enable the Asmo. I might just go to name Renin 6. Usually you want to name Aether Spell Bomb or Nihil Spell Bomb, but I think I'm gonna name Renin 6. And I want to cast the Needle, of course, here on turn one so that I can cast my Imri on turn two. And even if it dies, like hopefully Imri will mill over something good to unearth. We had Urza's Saga and a Tarmogoyf, okay. We draw our own Urza's Saga, so I think I'll play that and cast an Imri. You know, I've definitely found when I'm playing a deck like Jund Saga, which I'm assuming is what my opponent's on. They are on Jund Saga. Like the problem is like your sagas are so much worse than your opponent's sagas. Like you're making like 3/3s and your opponents are making like 6/6s. Although if you're making 2-mana 5/5s, this is definitely a good way to keep up. Okay, so goes to chapter 2. So I could potentially go Unearth Manufactor, Bone Shards, but I can't also play the Asmo. Shoots. Definitely a tricky spot. I feel like we should Bone Shards a Tarmogoyf. I'm gonna discard, I think, a Bauble. I'm not 100% sure this is correct. Oh, and it's really bad here. I milled over my basic swamp, so I have to take 2 damage that I really would have preferred not to. And next turn, we can, you know, unearth our manufacturer, make a lot of game objects. But we may fall a little bit behind here, especially if my opponent just like grab Shadow Spear and equips to Tarmogoyf. Opponent grabs a Pithing Needle. I will say our deck is pretty soft to Needle on Cookbook. Yeah, they do Needle Cookbook. Although Needle on Cookbook means the Turok's not growing at least. Okay. So probably making a Saga token now. And then I'm not sure what we're getting. We could get an Aether Spell Bomb. Shadow Spear. I think I kind of like the Shadow Spear. Then I can unearth my Imri, chump block the Tarmogoyf with Asmo, equip the Shadow Spear to my now 4/4 construct and 5/5, and start to race. This plan seems fine. Milled over an Oval Chase Daredevil. It's not very relevant with my Cookbook Needle, though. You know, being a blue-black deck, pretty tough to remove artifacts. I will say Needle is a problem, but not a problem against a huge, huge range of decks, at least. Hopefully my opponent's follow-up isn't too good. So it's tapping a black. Maybe they're going to just cast a discard spell. I believe my artifacts in the yard are Manufactor, Mishra's Bauble. Manufactor can represent Chump Blockers turn after turn, cast off the Imri. Oh, they're going to EE on one. This is actually low-key very fine. Because this may actually let me cast my Asmo, unlock the cookbook. We draw another copy of Urza Saga. So I guess I'm going to go play Saga. Cast Manufactor. Just pass back. Opponent, I think, is like somewhat incentivized to use their mana to pop the explosives now. Now I can get a cookbook back, which is just so important for my hand. I guess that's one way to get a needle off the battlefield. Although we are dead to terminate Red and Six pinging. Okay. Good line, opponent. We go to game three. We're on the play for game three. How do I feel about my cyber plan? I think I feel pretty good about it. I don't think I want the third bone charge, especially not on the play. Just feel, I think, just fine resubmitting this. Down the plate. Okay, easy keep. We have a turn to Shredder Bauble. I think I will cast a spell on turn one. Could hold it to either shred away though, or to trigger Shredder later. Opponent probably has a removal spell. I think I still need to use my mana. It's fine, because it, also like if this Shredder dies here, then I push, right? Yeah. If the Shredder dies, then maybe my Manufacturer gets to live, which is important. Ren and Six on top. We'll see if they have a fetch land to go with that. Seems they have a Saga, maybe not a fetch land. Shadow Spear. Five other cards in their hand. Okay, so we'll go second Shredder, Cookbook. Love to find a Daredevil. Right, second Shredder down. I think I have to discard the Bone Shards. I'm just kind of like light on resources, I think, for this Bone Shards to really do enough for me. I don't think I mentioned this in the deck tech either. There's a lot going on. I couldn't really cover everything, but Minamo is here so that you can untap it to your... untap your Imri with it. So here my opponent's probably going to make a Saga token end of turn. I'm going to make a three tokens, and they're going to be able to needle my cookbook again, which, like I mentioned, is definitely a problem for our archetype. In like a lot of ways, I feel like needle is like some of the hardest hate to beat. Like the graveyard hate you can kind of play through. I guess like, you know, Stony Silence, and so like Stony Silence is like just not played at all really. But yeah, needle on your cookbook just really is a huge needle in your game plan. You do have an Odawara as a way to bounce it. Obviously you could splash like green or white or something to answer it, but it at least hasn't been like such a big problem that I felt like I felt the need to do that yet or anything. Okay. And they can take an extra turn. Doesn't necessarily accomplish as much as I might like, though. I think I'll just sack this clue for a card. All right, then I'll play this Watergrave tapped, and I can bounce the construct that they equipped the Shadow Spear, at least like stop them from equipping Shadow Spear by holding this up. I'm not gonna play around second Pithing Needle on Aether Spellbomb. Second Pithing Needle is really uncommon, but you know, to be honest, maybe like a little underplayed. And they've assembled Ren and Six plus Saga, and I really just like don't have too many, I think, avenues to victory here. We'll try to play it out, of course. Well. Oh, my opponent just has Unearth. Okay, let's Earth Spellbomb. Maybe they'll miss that they have Spellbomb. It's just that easy. The key The key there is to cast the simply cast the unearth with enough confidence that it will resolve. It's quite simple. Although here, maybe I was supposed to cast the bone shards. I don't really see how I won this game without just like casting a second shredder and like time sieving somehow next turn and like beating down. So I think that's, if that's the only way I can see myself winning this game, that's probably the line I should try to take. Step one was definitely my opponent forgetting the spell bomb. And they're main phase spell bombing me, which doesn't really accomplish much. And they didn't draw a card. I don't know if that's... Oh, they're doing this for Delirium. Okay. They probably should have responded to the spellbomb trigger with the heat. Since I could potentially unearth this now. Obviously not that big a deal. There's a cookbook in the yard, which does actually, you know, enable an extra turn. Oh, although it doesn't, right? Because I have to use my treasure and my food, I think, to gain 3 life this turn to survive. We got another Nile Spellbomb 2, which stops my Emery. I think I might just concede. Yeah, we don't have an avenue to victory here, unfortunately. I had an awesome game 1. Games 2 and 3, really, I feel like lost to this pithy needle. I see you guys in round number 3. Okay, we are on the play for round number 3 with what seems to be pretty strong 7-card hand. Kind of lacking a Oval Chase Daredevil, but that's fine. Not every hand can have everything. We get to go turn 1 Cookbook, turn 2 Asmo, turn 3 Activate Saga. Definitely the kind of hand you just love to have on the play game 1. Opponent's playing Mishra's Bauble, turning themselves so that you can infer that they have both a fetch land and a non-fetch land in their hand. So can infer that there's still a not, you know, still a land in the hand. Well, unlikely that that's information we can use it all. You know, it may become relevant. Like if they just go like, if they play like 2 fetch lands in a row, we should be able to infer that they have a another non-fetch land in the hand. Although I guess they could be taking this line with just go to the Delta actually. They could also be taking this line, I guess, if they just have like nothing else to do with their turn 1, which kind of seems like that's the case actually. So I've just spent the first minute of this match rambling for nothing. Disregard. They do cast a Consider. Looks like we were playing it with Blue Red Murktide. They put their Ode of War in the graveyard. I'm gonna F6. I can't really imagine a scenario where I end up discarding anything to my second cookbook this game. They play the 4th Mishra's Bauble. And maybe nothing else. I think what they're thinking about, no, they can't play a Murktide into my Asmo here. Yeah, there's no way. I think that seems like maybe that's what they were considering. And that is the perfect draw. I was just about to talk about how good a Daredevil top deck would be, because that would enable me to take an extra turn in 2 turns, and then I can get a 3rd cookbook off my Urza Saga, and I'll be able to make 3 tokens a turn, which will, you know, effectively net, you know, 3/5 of a turn every turn cycle. And, you know, while not infinite turns, as soon as I find a manufacturer, the game just ends. Although I might just be able to, you know, attack them. I think I could just attack them twice. I think, yeah, 1 extra turn should actually just get this job done, right? Especially because sometimes, guys, you just have it all. Sometimes you just have it all. I don't even need to take an extra turn here. I'm just going to attack them for... I'm just going to attack them for like 17. Okay. Very, very fast game one against Blue Red Murktide. And the main matchup we have these bone shards for are the Murktide matchup, or is the Murktide matchup. I also want Needle, because usually Murktide is playing either Relic of Virginitas or Unlicensed Hearse as their graveyard hate of choice. We don't really mind too much which one it is, because we can get the Needle once we know. And it's really nice to be able to Needle the graveyard hate. And then I do usually like to leave in the Nile Spellbomb. I think I usually cut the Springleaf Drum, because Springleaf Drum is a bit worse against the deck that has a lot of cheap interaction against you. And I kind of waffle between cutting the fourth Manufacturer, or like fourth Bauble, fourth Shredder. I think I'm gonna cut the fourth Manufacturer and click Submit. I think a lot of people in the comments probably think that this is pronounced Academy Manufacturer. I think I've actually said Manufacturer a couple times. I'm still kind of in the habit, but I learned not that long ago that it's pronounced Academy Manufacturer, not Manufacturer. But I won't police you if you don't want to switch pronouncing. This hand is really, really close. This hand needs a non-Urza Saga land in really like the top three cards if I want to use the Bauble. And this is a matchup it's hard to mulligan in. I think I'm supposed to keep it. Again, against Murktide, it's hard to mulligan very aggressively. This hand, we had a hand very similar to this earlier, and you can just see how good like the potential like turn two Shredder is. And while we don't have that here, we do have, you know, Cookbook Daredevil, and we have two more looks at a untapped land for next turn. And I think I'm just gonna try to ride that to victory. My opponent's top card is Scalding Tarn. They don't decide to shuffle it away, so I kind of feel like they should have just got Steam Vents end of turn, but you know, doesn't really matter that much. And I'll just discard the Daredevil here. And we got two draw steps at a untapped colored source, and instead we draw Urza Saga, which we'll have to make do with. Hope I don't get Blood Mooned. I'm probably gonna cycle this Unearth now. But we are still making a token every turn, and you know, with a time sieve in your hand, like the sooner you start making a lot of tokens, the better. Cause like if you just have a fleet of food, you're setting up for a turn where you can play Time Sieve and take an extra turn immediately. My opponent plays Ragavan, that's fine. I'm going to cycle the Unearth. Bone Shards, huh? There's our Watery Grave. So I guess I'm just going to go float a mana, get another cookbook or no, I set it out the Springleaf Drum, so we'll just get the cookbook, and then actually gonna make a token, I think, since my ability to make a token is otherwise pretty hindered. I can take a hit from the Ragavan. Famous last words, maybe. If they have Dress, and this construct can only really be killed by Dress Down or Archmage's Charm at this point, or I guess Engineered Explosives would be worst case scenario. But if they do kill a Dress Down, they don't get their Ragavan trigger, which is, I think, fine. In fact, here, I may just Needle Engineered Explosives, because that definitely seems like big issue here. And I think because I have this floating Colas mana, it's probably correct for me to go for Asmo this turn. I get countered. But I ideally want to be able to use that extra colored Colas mana on the food token. And I'm gonna not be too worried about being hit by Ragavan and attack for 10. They decide just to jump block. Opponent's got 15 life points. My construct is growing by 2 a turn. They can't engineered explosives me until they deal with the needle, but explosives is probably their only way to deal with needle anyways. Channeler. Heat. So they're going to double heat. Well, I'm glad I ended up making this token since it's effectively a 3-for-1. They put another heat in the yard and they kept the card on top. Okay. And then now they're playing another Murktide Regent or their first Murktide Regent, whatever. But I have a Bone Shards for this. So I would love to draw a untapped land. They'd be able to play my Time Sieve this turn. Awesome. Not a winning line or immediately winning line. It's definitely going to start to swing the game back in my favor a little bit here, I think. I'm going to get to take another turn here as well. And I guess I get to also Imri. So let's go. Bone Shards, discard, Daredevil. Then go discard Daredevil, make a food. Discard Daredevil, make a food. Take an extra turn. Play Imri. I only have Bauble at the moment. That's, I think, fine. Let's go Unearth Asmo. Get a third cookbook, which advances my turn making by 1. And I think I'm going to get a little greedy. I guess it's not that greedy, but I'm going to sacrifice one of my cookbooks and the Bauble to take an extra turn here and the 3 foods. And I can just replay the third cookbook off the Imri next turn. Which is what I'm going to do. So done taking turns for now, but that should be fine, right? Yeah, I guess I could sack like the needle here. I think that's probably asking for trouble. I feel ahead enough that seems unnecessary. About 18 life, it got engineered explosives needle. We can just we'll take an extra turn next turn. But it has a best start to most turns in the late game. Expressive iteration. It says turn 8 here, right? My eyes ain't so good, but it's actually their turn 6. They find a lightning bolt and they bolt the Imri. It's gonna be a fine, I suppose. Discard engineered or mill over explosives. I could maybe have used my food to kill the channeler, but that's 2/5 of a turn right there. So they play a Murktide, or maybe try to trade Murktide for a portion of an extra turn. All right, so we'll go Saga. Saga's probably close to game over here. Saga, Shredder, Spellbomb, Connive. Let's back it in. Okay, we advance to 2-1, beating Affinity, losing to Gen Saga, beating Murktide. I'll see you guys in round number 3. Okay, we are on the play for match number 4 of this league. We're up against a Yorion deck. If this is either Elementals or Omnath, I actually have found this matchup to be pretty good. I've only played it a few times, but I've had multiple games against the 4-color Omnath deck where I've like mulled a 5 and I've gotten like Besageued, like Rinnin 6 like 6 or 7 times, and I've still like won those games. And I'm not saying that those kind of games, I'm going to discard this so I can unearth it later. I'm not saying that those kind of games are like super standard or they're going to happen every time. But I think usually like when you're still winning a matchup and you mulligan to 5 and your opponent has like what should be one of their better draws in the matchup and you win anyways, in my experience, that's like a pretty clear indication of a good matchup. But instead of being a 4-color Omnath, it seems like they're actually playing blue-white control, perhaps Bant control. Prismatic Vista is kind of a tougher Bant. I'm actually been a pretty big proponent of Yorion Bant control in Modern. It's a deck I really, really have liked. However, it's actually like really only a deck that I can recommend you play on Magic Online. The deck is surprisingly difficult to close games out with, despite me, in my opinion, being, you know, one of the faster Magic Online players or Magic players in general. In paper, it's just, I found it tough to close out games in the Yorion control deck. All right, so I'm just gonna make both tokens here, try to, you know, get as much value as I can. I don't think I want to go like Springleaf Drum Imri and overcommit into a Supreme Verdict. I already have one cookbook in my hand, but it's really bad if they deal with this cookbook with a counterspell or something. So I think here I'm just, oh, I should have played, sorry, I meant to play my second cookbook first. It's okay, we'll miss a point of damage. Not the end of the world. But I would really like to find an Academy Manufacturer. Kind of seems like my opponent has Archmage's Charm and they're wanting to steal a construct here. But next turn, we can potentially present Lethal Weed. I know my opponent has Solitude, but we can do something like Unearth Manufactor, discard, make these like 10-10s. Okay, Ice Fang's pretty good here. Yeah, so maybe it does really feel like if I'm going to be like double discarding to Manufactor, I would really, really like to find an Oval Chase Daredevil. So maybe I will just cast Imri first, because that gives me four extra looks at an Oval Chase Daredevil. Although they're fetch shocking an untapped fountain. Really, we really don't get an untapped fountain when they have Mystic Gate. I'm trying to think like what specific spells you'd want to do that with. Like, in theory, it would be, like, a triple white something, or I guess it's Teferi and, like, Prismatic Ending or March of Other Light, but you could just do all this main phase. Okay, a little bit disappointing, but sometimes you get a little bit disappointed. It's okay. Draw an Asmo. Let's go for Shredder Imri. I don't think my opponent's too likely to Solitude me. This puts a really good foot forward. Does a lot of digging for a Daredevil as well. We miss on the Imri hit, unfortunately. No, my opponent has Solitude. But hopefully we get to untap with one of these. They don't have another land to play, and they don't kill anything of mine. Both of these are like actually pretty unexpected. I think I'm just going to start off with an Unearth targeting Academy Manufactor and seeing how my opponent would like to respond, if they'd like to respond at all. They just let it go. Okay. So let me just target this Bauble, I guess. Could maybe target a Spell Bomb or Shadow Spear, but I think the Bauble's fine. Connive. And why don't we just discard a second Bauble? Then I will go to combat, attack my opponent's Teferi. I kind of want to wait to tap the cookbook. I mean, I guess if they were going to remove something, wouldn't they have done it already? Are they going to verdict? Yeah, they definitely have Supreme Verdict, and I think they're either just mistapping or they're like thinking about blocking and then verdicting end of turn, which they probably should do. Oh, never mind. I was wrong. It's the Wandering Emperor. Okay. So let me go discard this Watery Grave, make a bunch of game objects. And I'll bubble myself. If I see something I really like on top, I'll just wait on the Asmo. And that certainly qualifies as something I really like. So we'll just go Clue Token. Discard. And I have two treasures. I guess I should probably... I'll just go cast Asmo, cast Cookbook, discard. And what's great about this spot is, you know, I have four Time Sieves in my deck. And even if they... at this point kill my manufacturer, kill my stuff, I'm gonna have the four Time Sieves is just like really, really strong top decks. I have the Clue Tokens too. Hard to argue that this was a bad turn. Draw my card from bubble. I didn't miss that bubble trigger in paper. Second Daredevil, you know, definitely not the best draw, but we were lucky to draw Daredevil for so long. Can't be too upset. They play their land immediately, make a Samurai token immediately, which is kind of interesting. I guess I shouldn't have six because I do have the Asmo activated ability. I'm not sure exactly if I'm going to use that, but I'll think about it. And I kind of, it looks like here they're just thinking about what to Solitude. They Solitude, exiling Solitude from the hand. You have to imagine that this is the most important thing. Especially because I don't have another one in the yard. They're just gonna like Solitude pitch shot. Wait, why didn't they evoke a Solitude like killing the Emery last turn or something? All right, if you gave me a list of cards I expected my opponent to cast, Tarmogoyf would not be very high on that list at all. If you gave me a long list of cards, I would have guessed my opponent might cast here. Tarmogoyf would not be very high on that list. Okay, so I'm going to go target this Nile Spellbomb, I guess. Maybe shrink the Goyf a little bit. The Planeswalker out of here. And then I'll go Unearth the Shredder before I cast the Nile Spellbomb. So if they remove the Shredder in response to... I don't want them to remove the Shredder in response to me targeting Spellbomb with Emery. I want to make sure I get this Connive and get this extra card, you know? And so then I'm going to use Asmo's ability on the Tarmogoyf. It's a 6/7. There's a Planeswalker in the yard, sacking both foods. And then I'm going to spell bomb. So like just in case they like kill their own Teferi in response to my spell bomb, they can't save the Goyf. It's just already going to have 6 damage on it. I don't recommend playing Tarmogoyf in Yorion Band's control personally. I think it does not. It's not what the doctor ordered, but I do appreciate people just coming out here and trying things to try them, you know. Maybe I should have killed this actually to kill the Teferi, but I'm also kind of fine if they just capture the Teferi and I get to keep my mana around to Time Sieve. I'm one mana shy of casting the sieve and you know, probably really going off here. Although my opponent did have 3 unused mana this turn, like that they could have used for Yorion, so I expect them to have something. But they also didn't do anything. They didn't like interact with me, so I don't know. It looks like maybe Charm. Is Charm. Happy they didn't counter the Unearth. Cash in the Teferi on my Emery. It's okay. This is Solitude number 3. It is Solitude number 3. Targeting the Tarmogoyf. I think... I think that it's fine to just kill my both of my opponent's creatures here. I think it would also be fine not to just save these for the time sieve, but if my opponent like can, I guess they can't counter the time sieve, but I mean I can time sieve, take an extra turn, Imri, even without all these foods. So I think it seems fine to just clear the board. Remember that the creature deals damage to itself when you use Osmos, so lifelink creatures gain 6 life. So we'll go make 3 tokens, time sieve, Imri, take extra turn, attack. Misclick, didn't mean to click okay there. Oh, I guess I could also, it's gonna be fine. It's gonna be fine that we miss, you know, 1 point of damage. Was a misclick. But we can actually cast the Shredder first. Then get some sweet, sweet card advantage. And we could have used the treasure to cast Imri, but now that we have the Watery Grave, I think we'll use that to cast Imri instead. Tap the time sieve, food, treasure, clue, sacked, I think. Let me take an extra turn, and I did mill over a manufacturer, so this is game over, infinite turns, assembled. And then part of Paxton. Okay, pretty cool game one against Banth Tarmo Control. I think I want to cut the Shadow Spear and the Aether Spellbomb and bring in 2 Thonsies. And click submit. Kind of, well, maybe I want to cut the Time Sieve. Don't think I want Aether Spell Bomb. It can be okay against their removal, but it's like on board. It's kind of slow. Don't think I want Bone Shards. Don't think I want Needle. I mean, Needle's like okay. Like sometimes the Wandering Emperor can be kind of easy to read that they have, and you can like grab it and Needle that first. Needle to Fairy. It seems okay. It seems fine. I think I also like want to cut the 4th Time Sieve. This is going to be a matchup where it's like pretty dangerous to draw too early. Okay, I like this hand. Gonna keep. If they do have a card like Rest in Peace, which I don't really expect that they have in their Tarmogoyf deck, but if they do have Rest in Peace, then, you know, Shredder, I know Shredder and Urza Saga just make big creatures can be a good way to combat Rest in Peace. There you go. Misty Rainforest. Pass. And I think I want to prioritize resolving an Underworld Cookbook. And I think I want to bobble on my turn so that if I can maybe find a Daredevil off the on their upkeep and discard it to the cookbook. They're also like definitely gonna fetch in time for me to get the info. They get that beautiful Bant Triome. We've got a Solitude on top, which is fine. I'm kind of worried about March of Other with the Light on my Saga in response to the first chapter ability. That would be bad. We didn't draw our Daredevil, which is fine. Obviously, we got plenty of time to find one. I'm going to play a Saga, see if they have March of Other with Light. They do not. We do go Shredder, Bobble. Unless they have a counterspell, then we just get to... Well, I guess we still go Shredder, Bobble. We just don't get the Connive. The precious Connive. Yeah. All right, fair enough. So we know opponent has Solitude, and then they are drawing another copy of Counterspell, which if they don't have an answer to my Urza Saga, not going to be too scary. Okay. Yeah, not going to cookbook card for just a food token right now. Don't mind drawing a Asmo. We do need to find a Daredevil at some point. For a time sieve to be good, I think. As an Ice Fang, it's fine. That's Counterspell Solitude. Also pretty fine. We can Use Asmo to kill the Ice Fang and then attack the Teferi next turn. Also just needle the Teferi. I think I'm happy enough to discard the Polluted Delta. Yeah, I would be pretty like interested to like kind of like make my opponent use the Solitude on my construct. If assuming they like value the Teferi, that would be pretty nice if they did. Looks like that's what's happening. Or maybe they're going to Solitude the Asmo. They are going to Solitude the Asmo. Okay. I guess we just take this trade and then needle the Teferi and then think about playing Springleaf Drum off of the Odawara. I think that's fine. If I need a card to discard, I do have access to my companion, Giganta. Oh, sorry. I forgot I played the Urza Saga this turn. Okay, then this is actually the end of my turn. I got Saga coming, opponent's Teferi is needled. We still know that they've got Counterspell and now two mystery cards. Hopefully this is just Jorian in the hand. Hold up Counterspell. Manufacturer, pretty good. However, obviously not gonna just jam it in the face of a possible Counterspell, but this is I've got infinite turns. Assuming I can get through the Counterspell, maybe just get like one card in my hand to be able to discard. Thankfully, we have some time. Make a 6/6 token. I could maybe have tried to like bait by casting Asmo this turn, but it just feels correct to wait a little bit. And I'm just gonna grab Mishra's Bauble. Try to cantrip into something relevant. Not going to play anything into the Counterspell that we know about. Again, bubbling now so that if I draw Daredevil on their turn, I get extra foods, which I don't do. Force of Negation is definitely a really good card to know about. I do also have, you know, 2 7/7s. My opponent, you know, you got to deal with these. Looks like they're just playing Yorion. Just certainly not going to be good enough. They do get to reset the loyalty on Teferi, but they're going to need a Solitude to survive, and even that might not be good enough because I can go Manufactor, discard I think Bauble first, then I'm going to go cast an Asmo. I've got 2 food tokens in play to kill the Yorion, and they just concede. Okay, beat Bant Control to advance to 3-1. Pretty good match. I'll see you guys in round number 5. Okay, we are on the draw for the last round of this league. We have to mulligan, even though you can cycle on Earth to be able to cast Asmo. Our second hand is certainly much better. You have the choice of either just putting back Time Sieve or land number 3. Let's go put back the Time Sieve. Very close. Opponent leads on a Spirebuff Canal and a Serum Vision. Serum Visions could be a, you know, non-traditional version of Murktide, Serum Visions, obviously. But I've got a suspicion that this is actually Blue-Red Storm. Blue-Red Storm is kind of quietly making a comeback in Modern. I've seen it pop up more and more often lately. And how's our Storm matchup? We've got some Thought Seizes. We've got some Fluster Storms. Although Counterspell makes it look like my guess was wrong, which I'm kind of hoping it's wrong. I think my Murktide matchup is pretty good, and I don't necessarily think the same of my Storm matchup. obviously the Burktide's a really good deck, and you know, one of the most popular decks in the format at the moment. I can definitely lose to it. Yeah, but I think I'm going to Shredder Spellbomb. If I'm going to unearth the second Shredder, I would like to do it before I cast my second spell to get a little bit more value off of it. Discard the Watery Grave here. And then I don't feel like I can really afford... Okay, I'm just going to Spell Pierce this. Okay, I was obviously thinking about the pros and cons of cracking the Spellbomb immediately to play around a Murktide Regent. Seems like it is... going to be okay either way. Asmo can maybe deal with the Murktide. We can maybe make a big Urza Saga token to race with a Shadow Spear. But maybe they just don't have it this turn. They do play Murktide. It's a 7-7, which is obviously two Asmo activations, which we're not going to get if we don't have a Daredevil soon, I think. They decide to play their own copy of Shredder and pass. Okay, well, I guess I'm gonna go Unearth Shredder. Shimpan seems like they want to counter. Let me just put Giganta into my hand. I don't think that me triggering Connive on my Shredder is worth it if I triggered on theirs too. To just cast a time sieve and like not necessarily have something good to discard. But now I've got the Giganta in my hand, and that's a good one to loot away. And if they cast Iteration, I get to loot it away here pretty freely. Yeah, they're both conniving. Pretty clear. Discard the Giganta. And now my Shredder's at least out of bolt range. My opponent connives away. The worst card in the deck, Ragavan. and I've got two mana left for a second copy of Channeler. And Channeler is actually like pretty risky to play here. Like this is like definitely them saying they have a heat in hand for this Shredder. Because if they don't, these are just gonna get chewed up and spit up on my flying blocker. I'd love to make a token here, but I think it seems better to cast a Drum, Manufacturer, Trigger, Shredder, cast Asmo. Love to find a Daredevil. Yeah, not quite that lucky. Should I keep the Time Sieve or loot it away? I think I need to loot it away since this becomes a 3-5 to block these. And then... get a cookbook, and I think I'm casting the cookbook. Really need to find a Daredevil. Kind of finds a Consider. So they've got a really good chance of finding an Unholy Heat. They put a Consider in the yard, Ragavan in the graveyard, and then they... I think just kept the card on top off the Consider. So like that card's like either Unholy Heat or Murktide. It's Heat. Kills my Shredder. They are attacking for 9 in the air. So it's a lot. But if they don't have a removal spell for my Manufacturer, we're doing okay. Yeah, pretty good draw from them, huh? They keep a card on top. Okay, I'm feeling pretty bad. I cannot hide my emotions anymore. Feeling like we're probably gonna take an L. They exile an island. Murktide. Oh no, maybe yes, maybe not. Surely they're not tapping this to help pay for the Murktide cost, right? I guess they are. I feel like I'll just play an 8-8. I do have a Nile spell bomb I can get off the Saga. Okay. Trying to think if this really accomplishes that much for me. It doesn't really seem like it does. Sorry, I said Nihil Spellbomb, Aether Spellbomb. Also, if they connive successfully once to discard a spell, that's going to be lethal in the air. Okay, I think maybe my plan is discard Unearth to Cookbook, make a Saga token, get an Aether Spellbomb, and then sack my food token to gain life. Sack my food token to gain life, bounce the Murktide. Attack for 4. Maybe not the best plan, but it's the plan we got. And it's Murktide, 2 mystery cards. They seems like they're starting the turn off by replaying the Murktide. Imagine their goal is to connive and attack for 10 and force me to sack the food. If they don't do that, I could potentially sack a clue end of turn instead of the food to try to set up for like a time sieve kill or something like that. Just like not play around anything. Seems like they're having a hard time with their delve. Which is top deck Shadow Spear. Obviously, I wish I could have the Shadow Spear too, but I think I need to get the Aether Spellbomb instead of the Shadow Spear. And I didn't really see a line where the Shadow Spear got the job done. Okay, they're just going to combat. I just really don't think they've got the Lightning Bolt, right? Yeah, I'm dead to Lightning Bolt no matter what, because if they had Lightning Bolt, they would go Murktide, Lightning Bolt me, and then that Murktide plus Lightning Bolt plus conniving a spell away is lethal. I'm not going to just like assume my opponent like has a chance to actually miss that. I can't imagine that they would miss that line, especially after tanking so long. Maybe if they attack super fast, you could expect that they might, but I don't really think my opponent has much chance. So they're going for double Murktide here. Okay, so I'm going to sack a clue. If I can draw a time sieve, we're winning. I can use Asmo to kill one of my... I guess they could draw Bolt off Shredder, but we'll just lose if that happens. Can kill one of the Murktides, right, with the Asmo, unless I miscounted. I did miscount. Yeah, it's probably time sieve or bust. All right, that's a bust so far. We have more looks, though. We have a few more looks. It's kind of an interesting draw. Okay, so we'll go discard Shores, 9/9 Construct, Sacker Clue, time sieve, easy mode. No easy mode here. I think no route to victory either. Yeah. Unfortunately, taking an L game one. Going to bring in the Bone Shards and the Needle, just like last time against Murktide. And then the sideboard plan is -2 Time Sieve, -1 Manufactor, -1 Springleaf Drum. And then clicking the submit button. Been a pretty fun league. We're gonna lose this match. I've been loving this deck. Like kind of like I said earlier, it really feels like that perfect combination of fresh, fun, and competitive just really hits that sweet spot, really that spot I'm kind of always looking for as a deck builder. You know, when you're brewing, you don't always get to break it, but when you find a deck that can hold its weight against, you know, Omnath and Murktide and Shadow and combo decks, like that's the sweet spot you want to hit, and it really feels like this deck is there. On the play, game number two, companion, mulligan. Keep this, put back time sieve, and then I think we just go Shores Pass, and then we can, if we draw a Shredder, we can go Shredder Bauble, and then we can also just obviously cast the Imry next turn. I was thinking maybe I'd want a Delta for basics earlier. Maybe I should have, but wasn't sure which basics I wanted necessarily, so I opted against it. Love to see my opponent casting Consider and not a removal spell for my Imry. Almost definitely means they just don't have a removal spell in their hand. Bin's a Ragavan. See if they have a removal spell on top. They have a counter spell. Not quite the same thing. Oh, one other thing that the Gigantic Companion does for you is does make you like more resilient to Blood Moon, where you can just grab this, cast this through Blood Moon, and then use it to cast your spells. Oh, they found the bolt. Too bad. Not being too dramatic, but it almost feels like we were like ahead before they cast the bolt, and now I feel a little behind. I will go ahead and keep that Imry on top, but I can also get a basic land here to play around Blood Moon a little bit by just making a Saga token after I draw on their upkeep. And I guess I'll get Island because I can cast Asmo through a Blood Moon, but I can't cast like Imry or Shredder. So, make a token. Make a token, just get max value. Although there's like a decent chance they have dressed down. And I'm actually, I think, do I just have to get Cookbook? I really want to get Nile Spellbomb and like slow a possible Murktide Regent down. I know like the cookbook like unlocks my Manufactor and my Asmo, but it's just like so bad if my opponent slams like an 88 Murktide next turn. I get to cantrip off this as well. Okay, looks like they have Archmage's Charm. So that's good news because I was definitely expecting a dress down. Then I there's no real reason to do this any sooner than the draw step, but it doesn't really matter, I think, between upkeep and draw step. So for my Unearth, I have the option of finding Imry, Manufactor right now, but I can also just try to Imry first, and maybe that lets me find a Shredder, which lets me potentially cast Asmo after I get a Connive off. I think they have Engineered Explode. So they were paying costs and no mana got tapped. So I kind of think that means engineered explosives. But I play way too much Magic online all day, every day. And like, especially against an opponent who like said that they were distracted earlier. It's just way too easy for me to like read too much into like really small things I see and like try to overly read it. I'm kind of surprised they're main phasing this dress down. I feel like they should be playing that in their instep, actually. Still just Emery Manufactor in the yard. Guess I'm going to unearth the Emery. Did mill over a cookbook, which hopefully we get to play next turn. Like, maybe I messed up this game really bad by not getting cookbook off the saga, but just like stranding a Murktide in my opponent's hand, cantripping, just feel like a better use of my mana. Sometimes you gotta have faith that your deck's gonna come together all right. Iteration, always the, you know, scariest card to be put on the stack. Maybe we'll have a Minamo turn where we get to untap Emery with Minamo. I've actually won like a few matches being able to Emery multiple times thanks to Minamo. I have to check if I own one of those cards if I want to build this deck in paper, actually. I don't actually know if I do. They exiled a Scalding turn here. Is that right? Yeah, that's right. It's kind of hard to tell what your opponent's exiled Expressive Iteration on Magic Online. It really doesn't do a very good job telling you. My opponent does have a Murktide Regent, so guess my fears were confirmed, but they don't have a removal spell. So I'm gonna target this cookbook. Cast the cookbook. Somebody stop me. Okay, no, nothing bad has happened yet. Maybe I should have. No, I can leave the Minamo up. I don't think they've got a removal spell. They would have already used it. Then we'll kill the Murktide. Then I guess we'll use a treasure to untap Emery and Mishra's Bauble, or yeah, Bauble. I mean, maybe I could have gone for like a time sieve turn. It just kind of felt like something was going to go wrong, but nothing went wrong. Not yet, at least. Although, if my read that my opponent had engineered explosives was correct, things might get dicey. Although, if the explosives on one, it's not really that big a deal because they kill both their creatures, and I have Emery to get back my stuff, and if they close it on zero, I lose my Asmo, my treasure tokens, but I have more Asmo, so I can, I think, rebuild from that as well. Charmed all two, attack for three. We're definitely not too cold to this. Untap. Oh, no, they had end of turn dress down. Well, it stops me from winning with Emery. Stops me from doing a lot of things. Good play. Maybe better to bubble. Then probably doesn't matter all that much. I'm going to name engineered explosives and trying to think if I want to do anything in my instep. Can't cast anything off Emery. My top card is an Emery. Yeah, I think I want to guarantee getting all these game objects into play and getting two foods to activate Asmo. I think I'm going to Asmo the Channeler now. I'd rather sacrifice second Emery, I think, than the second Asmo. Okay, a little bit punished with Daredevil coming in off the top. That is like the card I was bobbling myself for, and obviously I didn't get it, but it's fine. Not the end of the world. Still like the missing piece of the puzzle. So they really need to kill my Emery since my Manufaktor, but the Emery I think is more important because of the time sieve in my graveyard. They put a Spiral of Canal into the graveyard with the Shredder, and then they just concede. Also, I don't know how they're like that flooded with six cards in their hand, but we will take it and we'll go to game three. I like my sideboard plan. This is how I've been sideboarding on stream too. So we're just gonna trust the plan. Click submit. Put in trust their plan too. They also click submit. Reveal my companion. And keeping this probably. Definitely like bad against Ragavan, bad against like Urza Saga hate, but I don't know, like you can play an Urza Saga deck and just mulligan every hand that's good against Urza Saga. Not me. I'll just lose to it. I do want to get a basic here. I think the basic has to be Swamp. Spell Pierce would be bad. No Spell Pierce, so they must have Consider or Lightning Bolt or I guess Heat. Consider bringing Dragon Rage's Channeler, which does imply that they have a land light hand or had a land light hand before the Consider resolve. Very good addition to the hand. So if this gets countered, I think I'm playing second Asmo. I almost misclicked there. Yeah, I don't really prioritize like just getting that Urza Saga down as quickly as possible like you might in some matchups just because, you know, your opponents are usually going to have a plan to beat your Urza Saga. Like that. It's okay. Oh my gosh. I did not mean to discard that. I can attack though. I can kill the Ragavan with the food. Ugh. Probably going to gain 3 life. I also have Gigant in the companion zone. Hopefully, they don't have bolts. We'll see what happens. I really hope me discarding that land doesn't end up like costing me the game or anything. You know, there's no AC in my office. We're trying to get that fixed. and it's kind of hot here in the Texas early summer. Delirious. Okay, so there's some insurance in case my asthma dies. There's an opponent over there. I can go the distance. I can deal 20 damage. If I just don't get bolted. Come on, Asmo, you can do it. And if I draw another, we could have enacted the 4-2 beatdowns if I didn't accidentally discard my Banamo. Okay, 4-2 beatdowns can commence anyways. Assuming that my opponent doesn't bolt the Asmo here. You know, one of my most common questions I get is like, what's your plan for Blood Moon in decks like this? And I don't know, you just play through it a lot of times and win. I mean, obviously, like, casting Asmo through Blood Moon, casting this through Blood Moon, looting away cards through Blood Moon. Like, these are all part of it, but I don't think that you need to have like a super serious plan for Blood Moon in most decks anyways. Like Blood Moon is actually like kind of at an all-time low since Titan and Tron are playing beside you. Like I haven't been playing Blood Moon in my Murktide sideboards. Obviously some players still are, my opponent is, but it is okay to just, you know, not be too worried about it, I think. Okay, well, hopefully they don't have a second counterspell. I'm pretty priced into casting this, I think. I can also cookbook to get back an Asmo. They do have a second counterspell, though. So we're just gonna pass back. Third counterspell, actually. One more untapped land unlocks my Gigantha. Gonna discard the Saga to get my Daredevil back, which I can still get in with. Asmo was actually not able to go the distance, unfortunately. Oh, sorry, I should make two more foods, even though it doesn't probably matter all that much. You never know. Daredevil, like, very actually serious threat in these, like, really board stall, low resource games. Like, if your opponent doesn't have any pressure, Daredevil is, like, it's just, you know, so resilient. They're going to bolt it and counterspell it, and it's just not going to matter. No, but here my opponent does have pressure. They've got the Murktide, but my life total is pretty high, and I've got Shadow Spear and the food tokens here. So this is maybe going to be okay. Especially because if I can equip here, then they don't have Delirium for, and Holy Heat, we can maybe just ignore it. Although now I'm going to Bone Shards while my opponent doesn't have any counter magic up. Cast my Shadow Spear. I've been really impressed with Bone Shards in this deck. And they do have the Unholy Heat. So I don't think I need to prioritize like getting the Shredder back right now unless my opponent has Graveyard Hate. Or sorry, the Daredevil. Like, yeah, I could draw something like Saga, which is a little bit better to discard than the Shredder. But it wouldn't be a league with an Asmo deck if Oval Chase Daredevil wasn't carrying at least one game. And also if I hadn't misclicked, then we'd be able to Kessler Giganta too. Sometimes you misclick. Yeah, I'm just gonna cycle this. See if we do anything, draw anything better than just equipping. All right, another heat, that's fine. We got time. We got time. Hopefully we'll have time. I don't know if you can hear Esther. She's downstairs. She's been yelling at MasterChef. she was like all weekend. Yelling at old seasons of MasterChef that are like 10 years old. Getting really into it. Can actually keep the channelers in check by sacking, you know, two foods a turn. Third Urza Saga is kind of like the worst draw in the deck, but it's fine, I guess. Opponent only has two cards left in their hand. Another removal spell. Yikes. Another unsummon for the 4-2. That's three Unholy Heats used, right? And then one Lightning Bolt. So theoretically, four removal spells left in the deck. Taking six down to, you know, a pretty healthy 17. Although Murktide Regent coming down, unfortunately, is going to make it a lot tougher to race. How many? I've used two of my Asmos, but you know, I would love to just top deck the third one, kill all of my opponent's creatures immediately, and be really ahead. Maybe I could also cast a Daredevil, right? No, I would be a mana short. That's fine. We won't be greedy. Asmo. All right. Well, maybe Daredevil's all we need, huh? The opponent has 13 points of power in the air. Kind of scary. They have to attack with the Channelers. All right, finally, he has a bit of a blank, although it still lets them surveil two, putting Caputa Delta into the graveyard, and then they're tanking on the other choice. Canal into the graveyard. Okay, just a slow input then. I don't like how much they're thinking here. Although I guess if they had a second Murktide, they would already be on the stack, right? Yeah. Oh, okay. They would not have been already on the stack. Kind of surprised. I guess they just don't want to. They just want to play it as a 3/3. Okay. It may be Asmo or bust this turn. Let's see what we draw. Another cookbook. Definitely not. Not going to be a big game changer, unfortunately. We attack here for 5. My opponent probably blocks. They might just not think it's that necessary, thinking I can't do anything, and they'd be right. And then if I gain 3 more life up to 12, I'm dead in the air if they block or don't block. So I guess I'll save them the agonizing decision, right? Let me 8, 12. Yeah, okay. Unfortunate. Kind of an anticlimactic last game. It feels extra bad that I misclicked and discarded the land. I could have cast Giganta. Maybe the game would have been different. Maybe it wouldn't have. But either way, we finished this league 3-2. The league was at least really fun. I hope you enjoyed the games. I've been Aspiring Spike. I recommend this deck, and I will see you next week. Bye.